Classification of muscles. Earlier we saw the description of active movements. Before understanding the muscles' adaptation to various types of active exercises, it's important to understand the classification of muscles. Muscles are classified anatomically: cardiac, smooth, and skeletal. Cardiac definitely has a separate autonomic control. It has an independent control. Smooth muscles are controlled by the involuntary parts of the nervous system. Skeletal is mostly voluntary, but sometimes the skeletal muscles can work involuntary also when you are checking the deep tendon reflexes or during any kind of a protective response or even equilibrium reactions. Okay, the skeletal muscles will act as an involuntary one. And even in neonatal reflexes, children, when you are holding the children, when you touch, immediately the baby will turn this side. Or when you keep in the palm, grasp reflex will come. This is skeletal muscle only in the children. You will be happy that the baby is holding my finger. It's a reflex. Okay? And then next is shape of the muscle. Some muscles are linear, palmar is longus. Example, sartorius. Circular, orbicularis, oris, orbicularis, oculi. Triangular, deltoid muscles. Trapezoidal, the name itself, trapezius. Okay? And then square or ovoid shapes, where we have for ovoid as major and minor. Fiber arrangement, remember some fibers can be arranged unipennate. Unipennate means like this. Other ones can be bipennate. Okay, both the sides. Some of them can be like this, like this. In deltoid, the middle fibers have multipennate arrangements. Okay? Most of the other muscles are unipennate like lumbricals. Some of the intrasai, the palmar and the dorsal intrasai, they are bipennate. Okay? Both the metacarpals. Action of the muscles, we are very familiar. Some muscles produce the action to produce the movement in the same direction. That is agonist. Antagonist prevents the movement in the opposite direction. That means the flexion, flexor is a agonist. For flexion, extensor is a antagonist. Okay, it prevents the flexion. And then again synergist, they work together with the agonist or the prime mover. Classifying muscles depending upon their action. Remember, it's commonly used in physical therapy. And the second one, understanding the basic principle of physics, we have first order, second order and third order lever muscles. First order lever is called as the lever of stability, where the fulcrum is between the effort and the weight. Effort means insertion, fulcrum is joint, weight is the center of gravity of the body. Second order lever, fulcrum is there, weight is between the fulcrum and the effort, where you have, it is the lever of mobility. For the first order lever, the best examples are upper cervical spine, the extensors, atlanto-occipital joint and the weight of the head. So weight of the head is W, effort is posterior, the fulcrum is between. Same way, the COG are the line of gravity, anterior to the ankle. Weight of the foot is also anterior to the ankle. Insertion of the tendon Achilles, posterior to the ankle. The fulcrum is ankle. So the fulcrum is between the effort and the weight. So in the foot also, in the head also, it's always the first order lever. For soleus, it's important there. And then the next one we have the extensors, which is again for first order lever. For second order lever, where effort is far, weight is in between. The best example is brachioradialis of the elbow. Remember, effort means it's mostly the insertion. In an open kinetic chain, insertion is always the effort because insertion only moves in open kinetic. Whereas in closed kinetic, the origin moves towards the insertion. So the effort will become the origin. Okay? So remember, brachioradialis, why? In simple terms, fulcrum is the joint. If insertion is far away from the joint, effort is far away from the joint. Okay? So you can easily tell if insertion is far away from the joint, you can tell it's a second order lever. In the other example, if the insertion is close to the joint, that means effort is close to the fulcrum. So the weight has to be far away. That is the third order levers. That is the brachialis, biceps, all are in the elbow, attached, inserted closer to the elbow. The weight is after that. So they are called as third order levers. They are called as the levers of power. They are very powerful muscles. Okay? The third order lever is the lever of power. And insertion is close to the joint, third order lever. Insertion is far away from the joint, second order levers. Okay? So rotator cuff, third order lever. All the insertions. You have the subscapularis, supraspinatus, infraspinatus, teres minor. All of them, the insertion is at the greater tubercle, close to the joint, fulcrum. Effort and fulcrum are the muscle. Weight is far away, the weight of the arm. Okay? So that is again another side. So remember that is the third order levers. And but the levers will change with the positions. During movements, the first order lever muscle will become a second order or a third order, or open kinetic to closed kinetic, again the liver will change. If hamstring is there, ischiotibiosity. Okay? For the hip joint, the insertion is far away. So it's a second order lever for the hip. Whereas for the knee joint, the insertion is close to the knee. So because of that, it will be third order lever in the knee joint. So hamstring is second order lever for the hip and third order lever for the knee. Okay, so it will be a mobilizer for the hip. Mechanically advantageous. It can produce the movement because long lever arm. Brachioradialis can produce the easily movement of the forearm in mid-prone position. But the biceps or brachialis means it needs a powerful contraction and they will produce the flexion against the resistance. That is powerful muscles, the third order levers. So hamstring has to produce knee flexion. They are very powerful muscles. Only during running it works. Okay? Or when you are doing a static squat like this to maintain, then only the hamstrings work at the knee. Otherwise, quadriceps only will control the knee flexion eccentrically. Coming to the duration of contractions. Some of the fibers of the muscle will go for a short duration of contraction and it will continue long time. That means short intensity of contraction continuing for a long duration. Okay, that is called as the short twitch fibers, which are mostly oxidative. Fast twitch is glycolytic. Oxidative means aerobic. Glycolytic means anaerobic. Biomechanical role, muscles serve specific purposes. Some muscles maintain the posture. When they maintain the posture, they maintain the equilibrium between external forces and the internal forces. So they are classified in one into stabilizers and the other muscles which produce the movements, they are called as the mobilizers. Stabilizers are direction independent. Whether I am moving forwards or backwards or sideways, my multifidus and the transverse abdominis will always be active. They are directionally independent. Whereas rectus abdominis, erector spinae, obliques are direction dependent. That means I do lateral flexions or I do rotations, obliques will be active. But transverse abdominis acts during flexion, extension, lateral flexion, rotations. All movements, even if I don't move, transverse abdominis acts to maintain the stability load. Influence of the directions. Sometimes because of the direction, what happens is the muscles which produce the stabilizers, they are called also as tonic muscles because they maintain the muscle tone, postural tone. Okay? And the other one which will contract during a short duration, one phase, another phase, contraction phase, relaxation phase. If I am doing this, this is contraction phase, relaxation phase. So that is basic muscles. So you have various classifications. Remember, there is an overlap. A short twitch fiber will always correlate with the stabilizer and the tonic. All three are interchangeable. Okay? Whereas the facing muscle is a mobilizer and it will be mostly a fast twitch muscle fibers. Okay? So understand these principles and then we see that oxidative and glycolytic, similar way in active exercises when we give different types of active exercises, different adaptations will happen in the muscles. We will go to that adaptations in the later section of this video.